of us single dads from the Midwest, we can talk about it. Bob of us single dads from the Midwest, we can talk about it. Bob of us single dads from the Midwest, we can talk about it. Or we can get gully, y'all size up your body and put some white chalk around it.
Welcome to the Single Dads of the Midwest, episode 21. Very special episode since I wanted to do 21 episodes for this podcast, and we'll probably even do more than that. But I'm very excited to have one of my best friends in the world, Sam Fischgrund, on this podcast, talk about computational complexity. In addition to being a software engineer, Sam is also a Quidditch aficionado, and I'm sure we'll have a plug at the end for anyone who's interested in playing a fun dynamic sport in the Bay Area. But for now, we'll stick to computers and such. But Sam, would you like to introduce yourself?
Yes, I'm Sam, and I'm here to talk about computational complexity. Thank you, Alex.
Nice. So I guess let's start off with like a definition of computational complexity and maybe just what are computers to begin with in terms of conceptualizing this concept.
Yes. So computational complexity is the field of computer science that deals with what problems a computer can solve and how fast it can solve them and how much data storage it needs to solve those problems. And in computer science, we have a very, formal definition of a computer. And effectively, it's an object that takes an input, can save that input to its memory or data storage, change the data that it's storing based on the data that it already has, and then produce an output, basically just spit out whatever data it's storing at the end of its at the end of its computation. And so, you know, effectively, it comes down to, for all intents and purposes, anything that you can think of that has a computer today, like whether it's a smartwatch or a smartphone or a laptop, they're all computationally equivalent when it comes to theoretical computer science. That may change in the near future with quantum computers, but currently, every computing device that we use today has been shown theoretically to be functionally equivalent.
Nice. And why, I guess the why will lead to more practical questions, but why does computational complexity matters, especially for maybe a more lay audience?
Obviously, you can do tons of useful things with computers. You know, if you want to, say, drive from LA to San Francisco to visit the Bay Area, right? You can pull up a mapping software and it will plan a route for you. Or if you want to dating app and you want to figure out who your best match is, pretty much anything you do on a device, the computer has to run a process to figure out the answer. So whether that's, you know, navigating you from point A to point B, finding your perfect match, or any number of other things you can do with a computer. And, you know, some solutions, some ways to solve a problem are much faster than others. And so if it's not fast enough, if it's not, if it takes too much, if it uses too much data when solving the problem, the computer won't be able to solve the problem completely or do it in a reasonable amount of time. Like if you were trying to navigate from like to your local grocery store and you pull up your phone and it takes like an hour to figure out what's the best way to get there, you wouldn't be too happy. And so that's why it's very important that we figure out like what's the best way to solve these problems, what's the fastest way, what takes the least amount of data to solve. Because also, right, like everyone, you know, wants like smaller devices. And if it uses too much data to figure out the solution to a problem, you know, then that data won't be able to fit on your phone or your device. And it, you know, you might have to like have your device call, like, you know, remotely call a data center to get data. And then you wouldn't want to wait, like you would need internet connection at all times to do anything. Or, you know, it just might not be practical if, you know, you had to wait in hours to get navigation. You know, you wouldn't wait that long. So how quickly and how much data a computer needs to solve the problem is very important from a practical standpoint. And not only from, say, like, not only for personal use, but also businesses, you know, they need to figure out, you know, how to streamline their factories and figure out, like, process, you know, how to make their processes the most efficient they can. And those all use algorithms as well, right? So like when a restaurant is figuring out where to place its, you know, franchises to better cover an area, they're going to have to use a computer algorithm. Or when a business is, you know, maybe developing some new type of material to analyze the material, they're going to be using algorithms and, you know, computations that need to run in a reasonable amount of time for it to make sense for the business to use those. And they can have incredible payoffs if, you know, you can save a company and a person a bunch of individual time and a bunch of money if you can find algorithms that solve problems faster than an obvious solution might be.
Nice, that makes a lot of sense. And how do computer scientists going about, or even program, just day-to-day programmers in general, go about finding, I guess, the fastest solutions and measuring what solutions and types of algorithms work better than others?
I guess like before the 1900s, you know, people were still using algorithms to figure out how to solve stuff, but there wasn't that much in terms of a general solution for any type of problem you can think of. Like there were certain problems that they wanted to solve and they came up with certain ways called algorithms to solve them. But then in the 1930s, a few people started trying to formalize it. So rather than focus on specific problems that one can encounter, like, you know, how, you know, like how to solve this navigation problem or how to solve this networking problem, they started thinking of more general solutions, like how can we solve any problem, how can we analyze any problem and its solution. And so somewhere around the 1930s, you have people like Alan Turing and Alonzo Church first defining what it means to compute something. So that's when you get the theoretical definition of a computer. And then once you have the formal definition of a computer, then you can start formalizing how fast a computer can solve a problem and how much data it needs to solve it with. And in general, like, right, we want to be more descriptive than this is fast or this is slow. But we can't use a set number in the sense that if I'm doing a matching algorithm between two groups of people, obviously, if I have 1,000 people I'm matching, it's going to run slower than if I have 100 people I'm matching. So like, I want to be able to talk about how fast a computer can solve a problem without worrying about my size of input, right? Like, obviously, if I am solving it for more data points, it's going to be slower. And so what we end up doing to formalize like how fast a computer program is we talk about how fast a computer can solve a problem given a certain size of input. So if a computer can solve a problem the same amount of speed, regardless of how much input you give it, that's called constant time. And what that means is like, you know, you could put 100 data points into the computer program, you could put 1,000, you could put 1,000,000 data points. It's going to take the computer the same amount of time to solve this problem. And so a computer that program that runs a bit slower might be, the speed of the program might be directly correlated with the size of input. So if a computer takes, say, 10 minutes if you give it 10 data points, but if it takes 100 minutes if you give it 100 data points, that would be called a linear relationship. And the reason they give it that name is because you can describe the relationship between the size of the input and the speed of the program with a linear equation. In this case, it might just be y equals x. And both linear and constant times are considered good. What that means is that if your computer runs in constant time or linear time for a given problem, that's generally a good speed for a program. But you can get much slower. So every time you double the size of the input, the speed of the program might, or the time it takes for the computer program to run might quadruple. And that's a quadratic time. And all that means is that the time it takes for the computer to solve a problem for a given input drastically increases compared to the increase in size of the input. And that's when stuff starts to get, when your computer starts, is trying to solve something and it's really slow, it's probably has a slow algorithm. So, right, there are, I guess, when you're talking about solving problems, there are two ways you can, I guess, go about making sure this speed of your computer program, when you're talking about solving problems, there are two ways you can speed things up. One, you can just get a better computer that does the operations faster. And the other is you can come up with a smarter solution. The first one is it can only help so much. You can have it run its operations slightly faster. Every year, right? Computers get faster and smaller. But there are so many problems where that's not going to save you enough time. Whereas if you go the second route, where if you find a smarter, faster, a smarter way to solve your problem, there are tricks that basically theoretical tricks that help you, you don't need to upgrade your software, or you don't need to upgrade your hardware. If you can tweak the software so that it manipulates the data in such a way that it can solve the problem faster, then you can have huge bonuses for in terms of performance upgrade.
Nice. And going back to constant time versus linear time versus quadratic time, and obviously there's stuff that takes even longer than that. Do you have any, I guess, maybe common examples of what falls into that category, example of something that's in common time, something that's in linear, et cetera?
So an example of a constant time algorithm might be, has anyone entered your store today? Like, if you're an owner of a shop, as soon as someone walks in, you can say, yes, someone has entered my store today. And so it doesn't matter if 1,000 people enter, 100 people enter, 1,000,000 people, you know, at least one person has come into your shop. However, like linear time, like if you're concerned, like exactly how many people entered your shop, then that would be an example of a linear time algorithm. So, right, for every person that enters, you add one to your account. And so the number of people is directly correlated with how many operations your computer did, right? Every time someone enters, you add one. So it's one-to-one correspondence. It's linear. And then an example of a quadratic algorithm is, say, a lot of matchmaking algorithms. So for every person that enters your site, you want to test their compatibility with every other person on the site. So it ends up being very slow, right? Because, you know, you're not just going through everyone on your site once, you're going through every person on your site for every other person on your site. So it takes a lot longer. I guess if we were to reframe like the other ideas in terms of that, then like constant time would be like you join a matchmaking website and it just chooses whoever for you. It just picks a random person. That's a constant time algorithm. It doesn't go through a list of possibilities. It just picks someone at random and returns it. So it's constant time, because it doesn't matter if you have 1,000,000 options, 2,000,000 options, it's just picking someone at random. So it's constant time. It's very fast. Linear, and a linear example would be, oh, let's not look at how everyone compares to each other. Let's just, for every person, we'll just match them up with the person next to them. So you basically go through your list and you pair them up two by two. It's not a very smart algorithm, but it does go in linear time. And then quadratic is, right, that's when, right, like you look at every other person for every person. And so, right, you're running through your list of data points for every single data point, and that's why it gets slow. But obviously, a lot of times, the more interesting solutions do take longer than constant or linear time.
No, that makes sense, obviously, as things get more complex. One of the fascinating, and I don't know which one is the best, but how there's like all these different sorting algorithms, which are just like ways on how do you sort something, whether it's numbers, small through large, large through small, or at the first I was first, the way I was first introduced to computer science is, say you had boxes with unknown weights and you wanted to sort them low to high or high to low, I guess either way, it doesn't really matter. There's like different algorithms that are like more efficient. Do you remember what some of those algorithms are, or like how computational complexity plays into those?
Yeah, I mean, sorting, first of all, is useful in many areas of computation. You know, whether it's storing files, like, you know, on your file system, or you know, like putting people into a phone directory, right? You need to be able to gather a bunch of data and sort it so that it's more manageable. And I mean, based on like what you know about your the data you're sorting, there are different like optimal ways to sort it. So like, I guess one of the first sorting algorithms they teach is actually called bubble sort, and it's actually so slow that no one uses it in real life, but it illuminates the concept of sorting pretty simply. And it's called bubble sort because you have a bunch of data, and the data that should come first sort of bubbles up to the top like bubbles in water. So you basically make a bunch of small comparisons for again and again, like you run through it, and if something should come before another, you have it bubble up. And it ends up being very slow because you basically just, right, rather than being like, oh, this comes, this should come near the front, you look at only adjacent items again and again and again. And so it ends up being very slow. What's faster are things called, say, like insertion sort. And so what that does is it goes through and it picks something, and it's like, well, insertion sort, it will go through and it will be like, okay, this should be going the first slot. And then it goes through again and it's like, this should go in the second slot. And it goes a lot faster because you're not making a bunch of side-by-side comparisons over and over. You're trying to figure out what should be in the first slot and putting it there, and what should be in the second slot. But what's cool is you can actually get a lot faster. There are recursive algorithms, and all recursive means is you break a big problem and do similar looking smaller problems. And there's a merge sort and quick sort. And merge sort, it basically continuously cuts the data you're sorting in half, sorts each of the halves, and then merges the halves back together. But it cuts it in half, you know, up until it's basically you're comparing two things, and then it keeps merging the halves back together, and that actually gets very fast. And quick sort is another super fast algorithm. And the idea behind quick sort is really cool. So merge sort, right? Like you're breaking it up into halves. Quick sort, what you do is you just pick a random algorithm and, or sorry, you just pick a random element in your set, and anything that should go before that element, you shove to the left. Anything that should go after that element, you shove to the right. And then you recursively do that on each half. And despite the randomness of like, you just pick a random element as your midpoint, it actually ends up being one of the fastest ways to sort things. And there are actually, so I guess here's a good point to introduce when talking about the speed of an algorithm. It's usually not just one number, or one, I guess you could say, equation describing it. So a lot of times you're not just saying this algorithm is linear. What you end up saying is, what's the... average, how fast does this run on average? How fast does it run in the best case? And how fast does it run in the worst case? And so something like quicksort, on average, it's one of the fastest algorithms you can use for sorting. But in the worst case, you can always pick a bad middle element And so its worst case solution could be really bad. Whereas like merge sort, since you're always breaking it equally in half, its average case is probably similar to its worst case. So I would need to double check that, but effectively, right? Like different algorithms have different worst case and average case. And so you might have something with a super good average case, but a terrible worst case, which might be fine if, you know, you're doing like a, you know, consumer facing app that doesn't have any time dependent things, but like maybe, you know, you're building like a self-driving car and the decisions of the car can never have a terrible worst case, because if they have a terrible worst case, you know, the car could crash. And so you might choose a slower algorithm on average, but that's okay because its worst case never gets worse than a certain like speed. And, you know, so when choosing like how to solve a problem, like worst case, average case really matter. But yeah, quick sort when sorting tends to be really fast average case, but yeah, it could degrade in like the very worst case, I think. Again, I would need to double check. It's been a while since I took a complexity theory, but.
No, that's fair. I've sometimes heard the term like N or N squared. Where does that fit into computational complexity?
Yeah, so so I talked about how we define the speed of programs in terms of the input. So if you say your running time is N, it's linear. So all N means is like, if I give you an input of size N, it takes N operations to solve. So the equation is Y equals X. And N squared would be quadratic. So if I give you like five inputs, then it's five squared. So it takes 25 operations to solve. So as you can see, right, like something that's quadratic or N squared takes a lot longer to solve than something that's linear, you know, so Y equals X or N. I guess one way to look at it might be that I guess the terms like quadratic and linear are less precise. But if we want to get more precise, we can start talking about like, oh, this algorithm runs in like N squared time, or yeah, I mean, actually, I guess it's less about precision and more just, yeah, quadratic and N squared would be the same thing. Linear and N would be the same thing. So I guess it's just mathematical shorthand for like the name. Cause yeah, the other thing is like, we don't care about, the exact mathematical relationship in the sense that, Y equals X, Y equals 2X. We don't care about that coefficient. So, you know, if it's still, if you get rid of that coefficient, that, you know, Y equals 2X and Y equals X, effectively, the program is the same speed because coefficients can be affected by many things, and it doesn't change the speed of the computer program that much, if that makes sense.
Nice. That does make a lot of sense. And I guess my thoughts are, is there something specific in computational complexity that you're really passionate about or you wanted to dive deeper into?
Sure. I mean, yeah, I guess there are a few things I should hit on. One of my favorites is cryptography. Right, cryptography is the study of sending secret messages and receiving secret messages and trying to break those secret messages to read other people's. And computational complexity is very important in cryptography. So, you know, if I'm trying to send you a secret message, I can say like, oh, the way I'm making this message secret is very hard to for someone to read it. But what does that actually mean? What is hard in this case? You know, like, I don't want like a gut feeling of whether it's hard to break. Like, I want to know mathematically, precisely, like, how likely is it for someone to read my message, right? Right, if you're a government or a business, it's very important, or even a consumer who cares about their privacy, it's very important that messages you send stay private. And so complexity theory gives us a way to describe how difficult or easy it is for someone to read your message. And how they end up doing it is they find a mathematical problem that they know how easy or difficult it is to solve mathematically. So they can say, like, if you remember, like, in your math courses a long time ago, like factoring numbers. When you multiply two numbers together, say like 3 and 6, you get 18. Then because 3 and 6 multiply to get 18, 3 and 6 are factors of 18, right? They're numbers that you can multiply together to get another number. And right, if I give you two numbers, it's very easy for you to multiply them together, right? Like if I give you 9 and 10, you can go, well, like 9 times 10 is 90. Or if I give you like 7 and 3, you can immediately say, oh, well, 7 times 3 is 21. It's very easy to multiply numbers together. But factoring is much harder. If I say like, what are the factors of 21, it might take you a second longer to say, oh yeah, 7 goes into 21, so 7's a factor. Oh, and 3 goes in. It's not as straightforward. And so how this comes into play with cryptography, mathematicians and computer scientists show that, like, if you're able to read my secret message, the only way you could have read my secret message is if you also solved this mathematical problem that is very hard. And so, yeah, basically they take a problem like factoring that is actually hard mathematically, and they show that, like, the way you send a secret message, the only way to read your secret message is to solve this hard mathematical problem that will take a lot of computer time and a lot of computer operations to solve. And so it ensures that because you have a hard mathematical problem, it's also hard to read the secret message. Does that make sense?
No, that does. That does.
Cool. I'm also going to jump topics here. I mean, still computational complexity.
Yeah.
This whole thing is actually a more generic and very important computer science topic, where you show that the only way to solve problem A is to solve problem B. And you create this hierarchy of problems in the sense that there are some problems that you can only solve fast at a certain time if you can solve others fast. And over time, computer scientists have actually created this map of common problems that are used like for navigation and for like other, computational problems, like whether it's like predicting weather or figuring out like how to send a message from one computer to another through the internet. And they've shown that like, and yeah, they built sort of this family tree of like, well, if you can solve this problem, you can solve this problem. And sometimes it works both ways. Like if you realize that if you can solve problem A, you can solve problem B. And if you can solve problem B, you can solve problem A. Those problems are effectively equivalent, right? But other times, right, you can solve A if you can solve B, but you cannot solve B if you can not solve A. So they've created this family tree of problems. And that allows us to very, a lot of times, like, the easiest way to solve a problem is by reframing it in terms of other problems. And so the hierarchy is very useful because, like, yeah, if you solve something on a lower level, it can sometimes help you solve problems on a higher level. And that actually, and that actually brings us to, have you ever heard of the Clay Millennium problems?
No.
So the Clay Mathematics Institute in the year 2000 identified, I want to say, 7 problems that were fundamental to understanding like mathematics in very broad areas. And one of them was in computational complexity, and it's called the P versus NP problem. And so we were talking about like, like linear time, quadratic time. Overall, those are considered, if something is linear or quadratic, basically if it's of the form n or n squared or n cubed, it's actually considered pretty fast. How computer scientists like generally describe a problem like that is to say a polynomial problem can be solved reasonably fast. But there are problems that are slower than that, that you can't even, like, no matter how big you make the power that you raise into, it's still, the computer is going to run slower than that over time. But in any case, the problems that we can solve reasonably fast are called P for polynomial. And then you can also talk about NP. And what that means is problems that can be checked reasonably fast. Like if you have a solution and you want to say, is this solution correct? That's the set of NP problems. So P is the ones that you don't have a solution and you can get an answer reasonably fast. NP is ones that you don't, NP is if you have a solution, you don't have, like, if you have a solution, you can check to make sure it's correct very fast. But if you don't have a solution, we don't know whether there's a fast way to come up with a solution. But once you have the solution, it's easy to check. And it's a, if you can solve it, it's a $1 million prize. We're unsure if those two sets of problems are equivalent. There are a bunch of what we call NP hard problems, which are problems that we've shown are they can all be checked once you have an answer very fast. But if you don't have an answer, no one's come up with a fast way to generate that answer. So the question is, like, but that said, no one has shown that there's not a fast way. No one's come up with a fast way, but no one's shown that there's not a fast way to come up with a solution. And a lot of times it's described as like, that sort of like, most computer scientists believe that there are problems that can be verified quickly, but not solved quickly. But no one's proven it for sure. And it's $1 million if you can prove it one way or the other, I think. Most scientists believe that they're not equal, but no one has yet to show that there's no fast way to solve anything that can be checked fast. Intuitively, it sort of makes sense that there might be something that, like, that's easy to check but not to solve, but no one's been able to prove it.
Are you working towards $1 million?
I've thought about it, but I have no idea how to tackle it. And I mean, there are people working on it, but I don't think anyone's come close yet. There are some criticisms of the like P versus NP like consideration, in terms of some people think like when we talk about speed of algorithms, it's too generic. Like, you know, if you have a problem that is linear y equals x, so n, we'll say it's fast, you know, because it, for every data point, we'll do one computer operation. But if you have a problem that's y equals 1,000,000x, so for every data point, you do 1,000,000 operations, computer science will still sometimes say, oh, it's fast because it's still linear, because we ignore the coefficient. And people are like, well, that doesn't, is it really fast? Like, if I have to do every 1,000,000 operations for a single data point, like, is that really faster than say like x squared? Like, if I have much, you know, small, if I have much fewer than 1,000,000 data points, then x squared might technically be faster than
that's true, yeah,
a linear. So yeah, it's there are criticisms, but it is still a very fascinating like problem, and it's one that is at the heart of computer science, because yeah, we'll say what's it would let us know like what kinds of problems we can solve fast and what kinds of problems we cannot solve fast. The other interesting thing is that no one knows yet, I don't think, whether quantum computers fall under the traditional computational complexity model. We have figured out problems like, you know, so there's a question of, if we have a quantum computer, can we solve stuff faster than a normal computer? And there are problems that we figured out how to solve quickly on a quantum computer that we don't know how to solve quickly on a normal computer. But we also have not shown that it's impossible to solve them quickly on a normal computer. So we know for sure that we can solve them for fast on a quantum computer, but we don't know if we can solve them fast on a normal computer. And until we find a problem that can be solved fast on a quantum computer, but not fast on a normal computer, we don't know whether quantum computers are technically more powerful than a normal computer. That said, it is, I think, the common belief that yes, quantum computers, there are some problems that they'll be able to solve faster than a normal computer. But I'm not sure theoretically if someone has proven an example.
We'll have to see.
Yeah, The main one they've done is like factoring numbers. So factoring we know can be done fast on a quantum computer, but we don't know if factoring can be done fast on a normal computer. If it can be done fast on a normal computer, though, you do basically put a lot of secret messages in jeopardy, because a lot of secret messages rely on the fact that, oh, normal computers cannot factor numbers fast.
Oh, interesting. Was there anything else you wanted to talk about in terms of computational complexity?
Yeah, I mean, obviously it's a very central part of computer science, so there's tons of interesting things that you could dig into with regards to computational complexity. One last thing though I want to touch on is when you do interviews for software engineering at a major tech company, a lot of times they'll ask you to analyze an algorithm that you're using to solve a problem. So, you know, they might ask you to figure out like, oh, is the solution you gave me linear or constant or quadratic? And can you make it faster? So it's actually something that you need to study up on and, you know, practice when you're interviewing for major tech companies. Even though I guess much of the time, right, like you're not actually coming up with the algorithms yourself on the job, right? Like you're mainly, right, like taking examples of things that people have already solved and applying them on the job. But it's still a very important thing to know, because yeah, you need to be able to analyze, like, you know, if I write code and my website displays slowly because it has a slow runtime, like, you know, maybe I am like trying to show a sorted list to a user and I'm not sorting it in the fastest way possible. Or maybe, you know, I'm trying to like render a graphic and that graphic uses a slow algorithm with a slow runtime and I need to pick a faster graphic rendering algorithm. And so it's a I guess it's less important to like actually like, I mean, for the interviews you need to know how to like analyze it, but in like on the job, right, it's just more important to be cognizant of like, okay, I need to keep this in mind, and, you know, make decisions based on like research you can do. But yeah, that's all I have for computational complexity. But, you know, there's one other topic I have to bring up.
No, definitely. Shout out to any listeners that have listened this long. But would you like to shout out and promote Quidditch for a bit at the end as you do?
Yeah, thanks everyone for listening. Sorry, it's been a while since I took my computational complexity course in college. But I'm always happy to answer any questions about it if anyone has any questions. And yeah, for everyone, no matter who you are, I highly recommend trying the sport of Quidditch. Quidditch is a mix of like basketball, dodgeball, football. And obviously it's inspired by Harry Potter, but it's taken on a life of its own. And it's just a fun way to get out, exercise, meet people. Like if you're in the Bay Area, come check out my team, Silicon Valley Vipers, or a few of the other local teams. But pretty much if you're anywhere, most major cities in the US and many major cities across the globe have Quidditch teams. And they're all friendly people. And so it's a fun way to get out, meet people, get exercise. And yeah, it is international. The last World Cup, Quidditch World Cup in Europe had over 30 countries represented from Europe, Americas, Asia, Oceania. So it's a global sport and super fun.
Yeah, I've played too. I can attest to it being fun. But yeah, thank you so much, Sam, for coming on. Hopefully people learned about computational complexity and enjoying Quidditch, you know, two birds with one stone.
Yeah, Patel's like all-star for Quidditch.
Close to retirement in a sense, but it's been a good ride. But yeah, thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you for hosting.